Orthodox?
Yes, precisely. The Orthodox defense on the black side of the Queen's Gambit declined. That was it. Remember the Alicante Capablanca match? They played 34 games, and probably 25 of them went into the same variation. That's why, you know, well, they were talking about the, you know, the death of chess, you know, like there's all the best moves have been discovered. No, okay, we understand, of course, now we can smile. Then, of course, there was a boom, and other openings, you know, began to slowly push the Orthodox system out. And there was, of course, you know, that Nimzowitz, because he was one of the best players, right, in the late 1920s, early 1930s. So a lot of people imitated, started playing his opening. There was also, and then Loewe prepared the Slav. His match in 1935 with Alekhine. And you know, of course, well, he won this match and became world champion. Only for 2 years, but still. And his opening preparation was superior. And even if he had, you know, maybe a few opening disasters, but all in all, you know, he came out much better in the opening. So, but E6, no, well, in some chess literature, this is referred to as semi-Slav. Indeed, it's sort of like half Slav, you know, half Queen's Gambit declined. What's happening here is this, that black is obviously still thinking of grabbing this pawn under some favorable circumstances. For example, if white simply develops the bishop out, then d takes, and then nothing stops black from playing b5 on the next move and holding onto the pawn for good. In the 1930s, also, when this system just started to be developed, Loewe, of course, played this too. You know, he was on the cutting edge of theory at that time. And his famous games, including his encounters with Botvinnik, white went a modest move, e2, e3, opening the bishop, so now he doesn't have to worry about losing the pawn. So this then would serve as an introduction to a famous opening, heavily studied and tried in tournament practice, known as the Meran variation. Well, black is sitting there waiting for the white bishop to make a move, so then he takes, gaining a tempo. This is a similar idea that we see, of course, in many variations of the Queen's Gambit declined, and also in this variety. Then the black unfolds his play by playing b5, moving the bishop to b7, and then preparing c6, c5. Well, one of those systems where timing is the key. If black doesn't get after he does all this, if he doesn't get this pawn, go to c5, say in the next 5 moves, 7 moves, that pawn may be forever pinned back to the c6 square. And the pressure on the half-open c-file would give white an overwhelming positional advantage. So it's one of those things when you really have to know what you're doing. And but that was the you know, main part, you know, of this opening revolution, which started in the 1930s. Before that, oh, I just opened the game the way I like, and then let my talent, you know, take over. Well, it turned out, you know, that you can study the opening deeper. Obviously, a lot of credit goes later on, you know, to the Soviet players like Botvinnik and others who took this approach. But I don't think this approach was invented by them. Even Alekhine, you know, was known for this. Although he was such a great player that maybe he didn't really have to do it. He could use the old approach. He could outplay a lot of people. particularly his combinative ability was so much greater. But to fight a guy like Ali Khan, Oliver had to become like this. He couldn't just, you know, get a random position out of the opening with black and hope to survive. So Oliver showed, even against a superior player, good opening preparation can get you out of the opening and give you a good game and rattle your opponent and score you unexpected wins. Not only in individual games, the turnout, he won a world championship. You know, some sources say that Capablanca was so upset. He had an overwhelming personal score against Oliver. He thought, you know, what's going on, you know, it had to be, let me play this guy now, I'll beat him easy. But I'm not sure, you know, well, he would have won that easily, because Oliver actually made himself into a very strong player by mainly, obviously he had other qualities too, but mainly, you know, developing his openings and using this opening approach, you know, that is...
World champion for, what, 2 years?
2 years, yeah. But he basically laid down the groundwork of the opening approach we use today. Okay, anyway. Then, of course, the other move. Bishop g5. Well, that's an introduction to a very sharp line. Now, does anyone know the name? Does anyone know the name of this variation?
Smyslov?
No.
No.
No, it's not a Meran. E4, B5. White never gets this pawn back.
The anti-Morozi?
No, the Maraxi bind, you know, is a different system.
The anti-Morozi? No.
No, but that's not that either. Sorry about that.
That's not just the Queen's Gambit accepted at this point.
No. No, the Queen's Gambit accepted, you know, when you took on move 2. You take on move 2 that pawn. This is the Botvinnik variation of the semi-Slav. Named after great Soviet champion Mikhail Botvinnik, who, well, won the title in a match, in a tournament in 1948. And
some people call it the anti-Moran.
It's possibly you can call it that way, because white basically avoids the Meran variation by doing this. But there is a lot of anti stuff, you know, you'll bear with me, you know. So anyway, you know, this is a huge mess, because white immediately plays this, attacks the pin knight, and black is forced to play this move, you know, lest he's losing a piece, and goes here, and then g5. Must do this, and then white plays this move, sacrificing a knight, but only temporarily, because then the pin will gain him this piece back, and then it becomes extremely complex. Now, this variation was given the name of Botvinnik because of his tremendous successes just right after the war. You know, he got it all figured out. However, this variation was also played before the war by some players. Oliver had one game. Like I said, Oliver was completely the cutting edge, you know, of theory then. And also, probably the most talented German player of that time. His name was Junge. Never heard of this guy. He died in the war, was actually missing in action, you know, and then he, apparently, you know, he died, you know, as a POW. Well, and he was a very young player. He was barely in his 20s during the war. And he had a lot of games on the black side of this. Was actually fairly decent player, you know. He scored victories against best players, you know, just before he joined the Wehrmacht. He played some chess tournaments.
Did he ever play Capablanca?
No, he didn't play Capablanca, but he played Ali Khan. He played Keres. He played all the guys who played during the war in the, well, German occupied.